Hi everyone. Am I audible to all of you? Loud and clear. Okay. So let me set the agenda and the expectations from this session. The idea is to couple theory and some limited hands-on that we can couple in this session, given that I really don't know what kind of environments you all are on. I've tried to set up a cloud instance for you on Binder. It's a limited machine, it can do some basic processing. So the idea is to club a little bit of theory, a little bit of hands-on, and see how simple text analysis or natural language processing tasks can be done. Within 3 hours, I can't cover all the length and breadth of the topic. So the idea is to cherry pick and talk about things that people usually do more often, more frequently, right? So that's the idea. All the slides are here, right? And in case you have a local setup, the GitHub repo for code demos is this, right? The link to the cloud instance is in the slides themselves, right? So without any further delay, let's get started. Okay, so a little bit about me. I work with Jigsaw Academy. We are an analytics training company. I work there as in the capacity of senior faculty and subject matter expert. I've traditionally been in academia throughout, and my core competency is teaching, data analysis, consulting. Okay, so this is about me. There are a couple of assumptions I've made about the audience. Please let me know if I am somewhere near the actual target with these assumptions. So I'm assuming that most of you are interested in data analysis, right? I'm not assuming that you're practitioners of text analysis, right? The second assumption I'm making is that you guys know a little bit of Python and have seen Jupyter notebooks before. That's all the assumption that I make. And a little bit of Python, I mean you've worked a little bit with pandas, you know scikit-learn, you've seen a couple of codes here and there. That's the only assumption I'm making. This is what we'll try and do, right? So I'll spend the first couple of minutes in this session talking about basic text representation as far as ML is concerned for text data. Then I'll move on and talk about a little bit about what natural language processing is and give you some examples of what you can do with off-the-shelf library software that are available out there, right? In case you don't have Python or Anaconda installed on your local system, or you don't have admin privileges to install packages on local systems, you can click over here on this link and a cloud lab will spin up. I'm assuming all of you are on these slides. Is that fine? Are we on these slides? Just click on this link and we'll be able to. Oh, it's the code demo. This is the cloud lab. So a small instance will fire up, and it's a working environment in which I have installed all the dependencies that are required for the session. So you can let it spin and we'll start talking about the agenda for today. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what people usually mean when they say that they're doing text analysis, right? There are two broad category of activities people do when they say that, oh, we are doing NLP data science, sorry, we are doing NLP, we are doing natural language processing, we are doing text analysis. There are two broad kind of activities people do. One is simple plain vanilla text processing. The other is natural language processing, right? And there can be a little bit of ML involved here and here, right? So let's try and understand what basic text processing is. Basic text processing is doing these kind of tasks, doing pattern matching using regular expressions. You have data in PDF format, you want to convert it into some readable format, can be clubbed as text processing. You have data as HTML, XML, you want to parse it and get relevant data out of it, is text processing. You want to do partial match of words, let's say it's usually used when you want to do some very basic spell checking, right? So for example, if you talk about Indian cities, they can be spelled in slightly different ways, right? For example, Bhubaneswar and Bhuvaneshwar, right? So you can try and figure out using very simple partial matches if you know a couple of words are of one category or not, right? That's again text processing. So tools that we usually use to process text data are simple bash scripts. If you are Linux, Unix users, you can use sed grep awk to do basic text processing, or you can use some Python packages. For example, if you have to remove HTML or XML markup from any semi-structured data, there are excellent Python packages, LXML, Beautiful Soup, that help you parse HTML data. You also have packages that help you deal with PDF. You have a very famous library called Tabula, and you have Python bindings to it as well, right? So that's what people usually mean when they say that they are doing text processing, and usually people club all these activities together and say we are doing text analysis. The second thing that people usually do when they say that they're doing text analysis is natural language processing, right? And natural language processing is actually an attempt to try and understand the meaning of the language, right? And what are the things that we try and do in natural language processing? We try to figure out a way to split a sentence into constituent words. We try and figure out a way to figure out what grammatical purpose a given word doing. We try to figure out what a bunch of words mean in a given sentence and things like that, right? So when we do this, we say that we are doing natural language processing. So I'll focus initially a little bit on text processing, and then we'll move on to natural language processing. What can we do, and what are the kind of applications people build when they do text analysis, which includes some text processing and NLP? Anyone has seen this? What are we doing over here? We are trying to get a summary of reviews, but how? What does this tell you? Sorry? Rating and review, but on what? On certain aspects, right? So the ability, let's say I'm a third party consultant and I get a project of trying to figure out what are the good places to eat in a particular geographic location. The first thing I'll do is I'll probably scrape data from websites like Zomato, right? When I'll scrape data, I will make use of the text processing skills that I have. I'll have to parse the HTML, clean the data, deal with encoding issues, use regular expressions, clean it up, put it in a form where I can do some sort of NLP. And NLP will actually help me in trying to figure out all the mentions of food in the review, all the mentions of service in the review, all the mentions of look and feel in the review. Now this is a screenshot that I took from Zomato, right? So Zomato already is doing something very similar to this. Probably they don't have to do a lot of text processing because it's their own application. All they have to just do is just pass it through some sort of NLP pipeline. Here's another example. Anyone recognizes this? It's Amazon, right? It's Amazon. So you go to Amazon, and if you look at the comment section, you will see the key items which have been extracted. And the attempt at Amazon's end is to figure out a way to search reviews better by some aspects that they have extracted. Again, aspect extraction is a core NLP kind of task. It can be handled using NLP if your focus of text is such that text is grammatically correct, it talks about one thing only. You can use some fairly simple techniques to do something like this as well. So we will look at some hands-ons where we'll attempt to do something similar to this and this, right? And I will explain the theory behind what we are, how this happens, and I'll try and explain, also show you some hands-on, right? Okay, so let's talk first about the very simple way in which we can represent text, right? So anything that we do when it comes to data analysis essentially boils down to finding some sort of numerical representation of the data I have, right? If I'm working with retail data, it's fairly easy for the retail data would usually be in a numeric format, right? If I'm looking at post transactions of a chain like Walmart, most of it is already numeric and it makes sense to me, right? If I have text, right, and if I have text and I have to analyze it, what are the things we can do, right? Let's talk about that first. So I may be interested in just analyzing text, which we call as doing some exploratory data analysis, or I might be interested in building some sort of machine learning algorithm using just text as an input. For example, I may want to just look at a tweet and try and figure out, has Donald Trump tweeted this tweet or his staff has tweeted this tweet? So the input then to the model is not a number, but just the text as an input, right? So whenever we do data analysis slash machine learning, the primary assumption is that your so-called data has a numeric representation, right? And if you're doing machine learning, then you're trying to figure out a functional relationship of something with something. Usually, an example of machine learning within text could be the same Trump example. I have already labeled data. These are the tweets by Trump. These are the tweets by his staff. And I would like to figure out a relationship using text as an input to predict if a given tweet is by Trump or by his staff, right? So it's an example of a simple machine learning classifier, right? But how do I represent data for machine learning tasks? Anyone would like to make a guess what we can do? All the input that I have, so usually whenever you do some ML, you expect your data to be in this format. You have some predictors and you have some labels. Historically, you've noted down what was the value of this predictor, this predictor, this predictor, and what was the value in the labels column. So this is usually how you place your data if you want to do some sort of ML, right? Now, if in case your data is not a number, but looks like this, right? And I want to figure out a relationship between this text and that label, the first thing I'll have to do is figure out some sort of numeric representation of the text, right? What is the most simple thing I can do? I can get the sentiment by calling a Microsoft API. And what else?
No, not really, but maybe having a bag of words. Positive.
So very good suggestion. One thing I can do is I can create a huge list of words, right? And figure out if those words occur in this particular sentence, and then come up with some rules. Okay, if two word, two positive words, one negative words from my list, the sentiment is positive, negative. So I constructed one feature, which is a sentiment. Fine. What else can I do? Sorry? Word frequencies, right? So probably I can figure out all the unique words in this text corpus, right? And try to figure out, try to create a matrix which counts how many times each word occurs for each sentence, right? Okay. So for the label I can easily handle. If something is haha, I can just map it as one. Something is not that funny, I can map it as zero. And for text, I can do something like this, right? I can figure out each unique occurrence, right? And try and figure out how many times it occurs. When I do this, I say that I have created a count matrix, right? And now I have two matrices. This is my predictor, right? And I also have the label vector with me. I can use any sort of machine learning, okay? Is there an issue with just doing this? Is it too simplistic? It is too simplistic, but why? Sorry? Yeah, so what we traditionally call is that if you do this, your matrix will be sparse. There'll be too many zeros. Why would there be too many zeros? Because usually these sentences, each row in your data will not be just a single sentence, it might be a bigger corpus, right? And the number of unique words in your data can be really large. So the number of columns in this matrix can be really large, and not all words occur in every sentence, so there can be a lot of zeros. Anything else? Sorry? Yeah. Yeah, so let's say I say this is sentence one, sentence two, this is sentence short, then in my, the prediction that I have to make on my text says this text is funny. Now the funny word is not there in the corpus, so I never trained for that in my model. Anything else?
There are some very repetitive words like this, ease.
Yeah, so that we can probably take care of. I can just assign a rule that this is a list of blacklisted words, don't use it in the matrix, but a valid point. What else?
It does not consider the length of the document.
It doesn't consider the
length of the document.
And what do you mean by that?
Like if the first one is a two sentence.
Yes.
It may contain multiple this.
Okay.
And if the second one is a small sentence, like this is second sentence to really contain one. So it doesn't really consider the length of the sentence.
I'm not sure if what I'm understanding is what you're trying to say. Anything else? Yeah, so if you look at these two sentences, if you look at these two sentences, how do these two sentences, what word makes these two sentences different? This and this, right? But if you look at the matrix that I've constructed, I am giving equal importance to one and equal importance to two, right? Anything else with this text representation? Sorry? Yeah. Not if I'm using this sort of representation, right? Not here. I will consider, let's say, this first row in my data has 20 sentences. I'll just consider it as a bag as far as this is concerned, right? The exact question to your answer is, how do I figure out if a sentence ends? NLP is the answer. NLP techniques try to figure out sentence boundaries, right? And there are off-the-shelf pre-built libraries that can tell you within this corpus is sentence 1, sentence 2, sentence 3, sentence 4, sentence 5. But this representation is overly simplistic. This is what it is going to do. It is going to consider each row as a bag. Find out all the unique words. Anything else? Apples and apple. Yeah. So what he's talking about is there can be words which are derived from a root word, right? right? But if you do this kind of representation, then the duplicates also come in. What else? The order is lost, right? If I make a representation, if I write a sentence, the cat ate the rat, and then write another sentence, the rat ate the cat, both have a different meaning, but will have a similar representation, right? So all these issues are there with doing something as simple as that. That doesn't mean this is useless. This is still useful. A variation of it is still useful. Let's see what is the variation I'm talking about. So I think someone from here pointed out that we are not assigning the weights to the words properly. In the previous representation, if you see, if I go back, I know that these two words, rather these three words, are key words as far as this corpus is concerned, right? But I am assigning this as a weight of 1, this is a weight of 1, this is a weight of 1, and this also is a weight of 1, right? So I am assigning equal importance to everything. So we can account for it very easily by doing something like this, right? So if you think about it, what makes a word important in a sentence? There are two factors. One is how many times it occurs in the sentence itself, and how many times it occurs in all the sentences. If it occurs in all the sentences, is that word really important? If a word occurs in all the sentences, it should be weighed down. If a word occurs in a sentence but not in all the other sentences, then that word is very unique to that sentence. This is what this representation is trying to do, right? So we are saying that the importance of a word is directly proportional to how many times it occurs in that particular sentence, but is inversely proportional to how many times it occurs in the corpus itself, right? And when you do this, you say that you've constructed a TF, IDF weighing scheme, term frequency, inverse document frequency weighing scheme. Term frequency is how many times a word occurs in the sentence. Inverse document frequency is how many times it occurs in the corpus, right? So I can weigh my words. So you can see the weight of the words now is lower. The ones which occur very frequently across the sentences as well. The words which occur in the given sentence, it has a higher weight. So I can create a TF-IDF sort of representation, and if I do that, I can have some sense of word importances.
Does the attribute of a word, you know, I mean, it does represent a verb or doesn't represent an adjective?
You can derive those features, and for example, one in addition to, you know, this, you can expand this matrix and say, is this a noun? Is this a verb? Is this an adjective? And put a 010101 over here. You can expand it, but remember my sequence of pedagogy is, I'm first talking about simple ways of representing text. We'll talk about NLP. When we'll do NLP, we should be able to extract what he's saying are the POS tags. And then you can append them in the matrix and expand it further. Can be done. It's a valid approach, right? But as far as we are concerned, as of now, assuming this is what we know, this is where we are, right? So you can represent the text using a weighing scheme like this. We will call it as term frequency inverse document frequency matrix, right? Okay. Now, let's see what we can do with it. Okay. Anyone wants to take a guess? I think some of this has been answered, but let's, for the sake of discussion, go through it. Which option? It can have multiple right options, right? So this is definitely not right, right? Is this right? No. This is right. we can have a TF-IDF matrix with many columns. Suppose I am trying to summarize Shakespeare's, or I'm working on Shakespeare's works, right? So each novel will have a lot of unique words. If I create a TF-IDF representation, I'll have a lot of columns, and when I create TF-IDF representation, I lose the order of the words, right? So these two are right. Let's try and do this little hands-on, and see if we can predict if a tweet by Trump is by Trump or not. Right? Okay. So there's a very interesting. There were a couple of. So you can go to the lab, right? And there is a notebook called Trump.ipynb. So for the purposes of demonstration, I've already created helper functions. I've done all the processing, but I can show you some intermediate outputs and results. I hope how to go to this lab. Let me. You first have to go to these slides. Let me just copy that link here. You can go to this link, and that instance should fire up. So I'll wait for you to, you know, be at that instance, and then we'll run the demo together. Let me know once you're done. So meanwhile, when you are, you know, spinning up the machine or going to the lab, let me talk a little bit about what this data is about. So prior to Trump's election as a president, a lot of people followed his Twitter feed, and people observed that because if you follow someone's Twitter feed programmatically, you can extract the time of tweet, the device from which it was tweeted, all of those metadata. So people observed that whenever there's a tweet from let's say an Android device, the language is very Trump-like. Whenever there is a tweet from let's say an iPhone or iOS device, the language is not very Trump-like, right? It doesn't contain covfefe, for example, as one of the words in the tweets, right? So people hypothesized that Trump's staff tweets from iOS devices and Trump tweets from Android, right? So the data that we have is about the tweet, when it was made, which device it was made from. So the device column actually helps us in creating the target column. So every time a tweet has happened from an Android device, we will assume that it is by Trump. And every time it has happened on an iOS device, we assume that it is not by Trump, right? Any issues with this data gathering? Do you see any issues? Do you see any noise with this data gathering? Any issues that you see? Is there a noise if we do this? Sorry? Who can have Android as well? So we are building this model on a very thin ground, and just for fun, okay? So I hope your cloud instance would have fired up. I think I'm not connected to net. Let me, okay, I am. Let me connect to internet again. rather what I can do is I can run it locally. Okay, so let's work with this notebook, right? So the key thing that I'll do is I'll get the raw data, and there will be two columns that will be of any significance to me. One is the column which contains Trump's tweet and its text. The other column would be, was the tweet made through an Android device or an iOS device, right? And then based on our discussion, what will we have to do? What would we have to do? I want to pass Trump's tweets as all the tweets that I have from his Twitter handle as an input to the model. So what will I have to do? I'll have to create a TF-IDF representation of the tweets, treat that representation as predictors, and try to predict if it was made from an Android device or an iOS device. So scikit-learn has a nice module called text, which helps you create a TF-IDF representation. Pandas is a module which is used to read any sort of flat files. I have a CSV file, and I'll be building a very simple linear classifier, and I'll again use sklearn. So here I'm defining some helper functions that help me clean the data, divide the data into train and test, get the TF-IDF representation, build the model, and make prediction. I've already defined these helper functions. The train test split is based on the date he became a president. Before that, all the data is my training set. After that, all the data is my test set. Okay, so let me do the data fetch. Let me connect. Let me try to read data locally. My internet is not working, and the data is stored as a flat file on S3. So hence this error trace. Let me try again. Now it is working. You can run the same script on the cloud instance that you have. If it takes too long, I'll have to resort to local. Yeah, my connection is breaking. Yeah, so this is the data I have. So I have data on when the tweet was made, what was the source, and what is the text. So these are the two columns that are of any relevance to me. I will clean the data, and in the clean function, this is what I am doing, right? I am filtering out all the instances where the source of tweet is either an Android device or an iOS device. There are some tweets which have been made from other devices as well, so I'm ignoring that sort of data, doing some date parsing, and then I'm dividing my data into train and test. So here I'm cleaning it, dividing into train and test, and here I am creating TF-IDF representation for my data. Let me show you very briefly what my x underscore train looks like. Underscore so you can see it has got a lot of columns, understandably so, because I can have a lot of unique words. So all of those became a lot of columns in my data, and this matrix is really large. I don't want to blow up my RAM, so I'm not showing it on the screen itself, right? But the matrix contains TF-IDF weights, right? So here I'm using a simple scikit-learn API, xtrain underscore TF-IDF, which contains, which is a matrix of term frequency inverse document frequency, becomes my predictor. What am I predicting for? Has the tweet been made from an iOS device or an Android device? The underlying assumption is Trump uses Android devices, and iOS devices are used by his staff. Right? So I should get in classifier, which should be able to learn the tweets that Trump makes. So train the model. This looks like a tweet by Trump. No, right? So let's pass it through our model and see what it predicts. It's not by Trump. This looks like there is wall, there is Mexico, there's a lot of colorful language. This is probably by Trump. Let's see, right? So you can in that instance itself just copy paste any other tweet and see how the model does, right? So using this very simple representation, I was able to get to some baseline classification where I can definitely, you know, figure out a tweet which Donald Trump cannot make and a tweet that Donald Trump may have made, right? So this is the first thing that your TF-IDF representation helps you with. It helps me with handling some very simple ML, right? But obviously all the shortcomings that we've talked about, they stand. I am missing out on the order. I am not taking into account the grammar. I'm not taking into account the context of the language itself. So all those shortcomings still stand, even if you do TF-IDF. But does that mean TF-IDF is not good at all? Does it mean it is too simplistic? Let's look at some more examples. Right? yeah.
Can we use other features of the tweet by appending it to the TF-IDF data frame to build a model?
Nothing stops you. Right? It is one Python object, the other feature will be another Python object. You can always concatenate a NumPy array. You can do it. You can do it. Okay, let's look at another example that still uses a very simple text representation, but can still, you know, give us some intelligent, interesting results. So I have a data set which is which contains most of the TED Talks in it. So you have, we all know about TED Talks. So the data set contains a TED talk, its textual representation, right? So let's see if we can figure out the theme of a TED talk using a TF-IDF representation, right? Before I do that, let's pose this problem to ourselves and reason out what would be my course of action. So the problem statement is this: I have a corpus of data in which people are using grammatical British or US English. Each row contains, is fairly thematic. A TED talk is thematic, right? People talk about one thing and one thing only in a TED talk. So there is definitely is a theme, right? Now I want you to reason, I think most of it is already written over here, but I still want you to reason, how can you use a TF-IDF representation to figure out what are the key terms being talked about in each TED talk? What can you do? Anyone?
I can take some of the TED Talks representation, identify the main keywords we have, and for that thing, maybe we can give it as an input as such. Same thing if you use for another TED Talk, then we can use the same technique.
No prediction has to be made. I just want you to summarize TED Talks for me. I don't need to make any predictions. So the problem statement is this: I have data on each TED talk. What is the data? The transcript of the TED talk, which, and the transcript of the TED talk would be fairly standard US UK English, and in the TED talk the speaker would have talked about one topic most of the times. There will be a theme present. High values of TF-IDF should give us something. Let's see if they do. So what I need to do is take out all the in the data, just refer to the column which contains the text of the TED talks, and for that text create a TF-IDF representation. It will have a lot of columns, right? What would each row in the TF-IDF matrix represent? Each TED talk. So in my data each row is one TED talk, right? So each row in my TF-IDF matrix will represent one TED talk. What will be the values in that matrix? TF-IDF weights of the words, arrange them in descending order, pick out top 5. Let's see what happens, right? Let's see what happens. Let's see if we are able to get some context. If we can pick up important terms from the TED Talks themselves. So if you look at the notebook called Important Terms, let me read the files locally. So again here I have defined some helper functions, right? So this function that I have defined here called key terms, what is it doing? Once I create the TF-IDF representation of all the text for each row, what is each row in my data? Each row is each TED talk. For each row it is figuring out which words have highest TF-IDF weight. Let's see if we do that. Are we able to pick up some sort of context? Let's see. So let me read this data. So this is how my data looks like. I have a column on transcripts. Each row is the transcript of one big TED talk. I have the URL, and from URL I have extracted the title, just to make things easier for me. Let me create TF-IDF representation of this column. This column is transcript of each TED talk, right? Let's do that. Let's look at its shape. Again, you can see it has fairly large number of columns. We know the reason why. You have a lot of unique words, so it's fairly big matrix. Let's extract important terms. So what I'm doing is I'm going through each row in the TF-IDF matrix, arranging that in descending order, figuring out what was the column name. Let's attach it to the data and let's see if we got something. So what do you think? So the first title was Ken Robinson Says School Scale Creativity. The top weighed TF-IDF words are education, laughter, said think. The second title was Al Gore on Averting Climate Crisis. We've been able to extract carbon emission restaurant, right? So even by using a very simple representation of text, I can still get, although there is noise here, but you should appreciate the fact that I have done very simple analysis here, right? There is no neural network which is running over here. There is no deep learning which is going on in here. It's a very simple, from a very simple representation of text, I have been able to figure out some of the key key terms, right? But when will this approach work? What was so unique about this data set that I used? Will this work with tweets? There was grammatical homogeneity. Grammatical rules were respected. People were talking about one theme. So if I were to do the same thing on tweets, I'll probably get a lot of smileys, right? Smileys do convey context, but then it'll be difficult for me to justify this approach. But even this simple approach does work, right? It does work. Okay. Let me show you another example. We'll still use the same approach. Very simple, plain old TF-IDF, but we'll do something even more interesting. We'll try to build some sort of recommendation based on our TED Talks. So let's say I have first TED Talk. Based on the words used in the first TED Talk, I may want to know which are the other 5 or 4 most similar TED Talks. Right? Let's say I want to do that. How would I go about it? So let's first do a mental exercise and see if we can assign some notion of similarity to each TF-IDF representation of a TED Talk. Right? Let's first figure that out. So let's say I have these sentences with me. This and this sentence is kind of similar. Donald Trump warns China, threatens with tariffs. You have a sentence called Donald Trump raises tariffs, China concerned, and you have a third sentence in between, Obama makes a visit to Canada. Right? So these two are similar, right? We can see them, they are similar. Let's see if we can see the same sort of similarity if we were to look at their TF-IDF weights. And then try to reason if we can construct some measure of similarity between text. And then we'll go back to our original problem, which was, can I recommend TED Talks based on a given talk? Can I say this talk is similar to these 5, this talk is similar to these 5, so on and so forth, right? Let's see. Right, so what I've done is manually, these were my 3 sentences, right? Listed out all the unique words. If you look at, so this is a TF-IDF representation of the first sentence, which is this. This is the TF-IDF representation of the third sentence, which is this. Now, this is a slightly bigger matrix, so I may not be able to fit it in one screenshot, but do you see that the first and the third are similar? Similar kind of numbers are there, right? So ergo, what does it mean? If my sentences are similar, their TF-IDF weights would be similar, broadly speaking. Cat ate the rat, rat ate the cat will have exactly the same TF-IDF representation, but broadly speaking, with some noise, this statement can be assumed to be true with some noise, with some caveats, right? So what am I saying? I am postulating that sentences in English and their TF-IDF representations should be similar if the sentences are similar. You can see, right? If they are similar, then I can also find out. So this is one set of numbers, this is another set of numbers, right? I have one series of numbers, I have another series of numbers. Can I figure out a way to see how similar this series of numbers are to this series of numbers? Do we do that in data analysis often? You have 2 columns, you have to figure out, are they related to each other? What do you do? Correlation. I can find out Pearson correlation. That's one thing I can do. People who probably are who've taken physics courses, a set of numbers can be represented as a vector, right? So I can figure out what is the angle between the vectors. Vectors which are dissimilar will have higher angle. Vectors which are similar, which have low, will have lower angle. So I can also figure out what is the angle between them. What is the cosine distance between two vectors? So I have a measure of vector similarity. Right? I have two vectors in two dimensions. I can do this. Take the dot product divided by squared norm. I will be able to construct a measure of similarity between the two vectors. What am I doing? I'm measuring this angle. And if you look at the Excel sheet, doing this is fairly straightforward. The same formula just applied over here. I can easily compute cosine distance even in a spreadsheet, right? So, and you can see that sentence 1 and sentence 3 have some positive similarity. Sentence 1 and sentence 2 has no similarity at all. Cosine distance is 0. So this is the intuition. This is the intuition quantified. I could have also simply done a Pearson correlation. Right? So that means now I have a way to measure the similarity of text numerically. Let's go back to our original problem. The problem was, given a TED talk, you have to figure out which are the top 5 most similar TED talks. What would you do? What would you do? Can you create numeric representation of each TED talk? Yes, you can. What would you do? TF-IDF. Can you figure out how far each TF-IDF vector is from the others? I can construct this sort of matrix. TED talk 1, TED talk 2, TED talk 3, TED talk 4, TED talk 5, TED talk 6. Similarly here. Then for each TED talk, can I figure out which are the top 5 most similar ones? All I need to do is just again arrange the row in this matrix in descending order. Figure out the top 5. That's what I have to do. Right, so let's do that and see if we are able to pick up some context. Right. Let's open this notebook called Recommender. Again, in just a few lines of Python, I was able to put my thoughts that I've just explained to you. So this function gets similar talks in a single line of Python code, is able to traverse through the matrix, arrange it in the descending order, right, and figure out the top 5. So this is the main function which I'll be using. Let's run this. Let me read data locally. Creating the TF-IDF representation of the data. Next thing I'll do is find out the cosine matrix. I'll find out the matrix which says this is how far from the others. What should be the shape of this cosine matrix? How many rows, how many columns? Should it be square? It should be square. How many rows, how many columns? Number of TED talks? Number of TED talks. Right? Let's see what does its shape look like. Square. I had these many TED talks. Okay. Let's get similar talks. So this is not very visible. I've written a function which pretty prints. So the argument, this is an argument which I give to say for the first row in my data, the first title in my data, which are the top 5 similar ones. So let's run this. The first title in my data set is Ken Robinson Says Schools Kill Creativity. The most similar talks are Sir Ken Robinson, Bring On the Revolution, Ken Robinson on How to Escape Education Systems, Death Valley, seems to have picked up. Let's look at another. What is the second? The second one is Al Gore on Averting Climate Crisis. Let's see if we are able to pick up talks that talk about climate crisis. These are the titles of those talks. Rory Bremer, One World Summit, Al Gore's New Thinking on the Climate Crisis. Again, it looks like climate, right? So again, I've used very simple text representation. The idea was very simple, right? This idea dates back to 1970s, 1980s, but is still relevant in this sort of context, right? Okay. Yes. Similar themes. There's something called topic modeling. We can do that. Again, the representation of the text would be TF-IDF. You can put it. It doesn't really. So topic modeling, what it'll do is it say this is topic one. These are the top five words for the topic one. Again, you'll have to infer what those top five words actually mean in this context. It'll not say it is about politics, or is it? It is about cooking. It'll give you words. And then you'll have to decide, okay, what do these bunch of words mean, right? So again, if you have to, even if you have to do traditional topic modeling, you can still do it by representing your text as a TF-IDF matrix, right? But there are certain limitations with how we represent text as TF-IDF, right? The limitations are very clear. We are messing up the order, right? No grammar, no context, nothing is being taken care of. But if your texts are like this, is a very curated perfect example of the benefits of TF-IDF. If the text contains grammatically correct English, one theme or homogeneous theme, we can still use TF-IDF representation. Now let's talk about the other thing that people do when they say that they're doing text analysis, right? So the other thing that people do when they're doing text analysis is NLP, right? And most of the people, as many as I know, will use off-the-shelf solutions to do natural language processing, right? It takes a good amount of time to collect relevant data and to train ML models if you have to do something very, very specific. But in most problems, such as building chatbots or identifying the occurrence of a particular geographical entity, NER, people still use off-the-shelf equipment that is available, right? So let's first try and understand what will an NLP library do for me. These are the things it will do for me, right? If I pass a text to a natural language processing framework, right, and there are many, both in Java and Python, they'll do essentially these kind of things. First thing they'll be able to do is they'll be able to tell me if I give a paragraph to a natural language processing library, the library will be able to tell me this is sentence 1, this is sentence 2, this is sentence 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It'll also be able to tell me this is word 1, word 2, word 3, word 4, word 5, word 6. So the first thing NLP libraries help us in doing is tokenization. You can do tokenization using simple text split functions as well, but then NLP will be able to handle corner cases, right? That's the first thing it does. Second thing any NLP library helps in doing is, once I parse my text through any NLP system, it will be able to tag this word is a noun, this word is a verb, this word is an adjective. It will also be able to tell me this chunk is a noun phrase, this chunk is a verb phrase, and it will also be able to tell me what is the relationship between different chunks of words that I have in a given sentence. Right? This is a noun phrase, this is a verb phrase, this is how they are related. It will be able to tell me that, which is called dependency passing. The last thing that most NLP frameworks help you to do is, if you pass a text through any NLP system, the system will be able to tell you this is a mention of a person, place, political party, blah blah blah, right? And that is known as named entity recognition. These are the broadly the things that any NLP library will help you do, right? Some will do it by, the old ones will do it by handcrafted rules, if else statements. Some will use some pre-trained machine learning models to do this task, but most of the times this equipment, this is available off the shelf for us. We just have to do a pip install the relevant library and get working. Okay. So let's talk about NLP, and let's talk about a problem that I've shown you before as well. So we've seen the Zomato example, right? Where from the reviews we were able to gather the mentions of food, the mentions of service, the mentions of ambience, and then we were able to, and then in Zomato's application was able to say, okay, people like food more here over the ambience, or service more over here than the food, right? So this problem is a classic example of aspect based sentiment analysis, right? So you have a text, you try and figure out what people are talking about. What people are talking about is your aspect, or what you want to know what people are talking about is your aspect. Then you would want to know, are people happy with that aspect or not happy with that aspect? So there is a sentiment analysis part to it, right? And sentiment analysis also, to a great extent, is aided by natural language processing, because a negative English sentence will have a particular grammatical structure versus a positive English sentence. It will use a particular type of adjectives, a positive sentence, a negative sentence will use a particular type of adjectives, right? And most of the standard sentiment analysis can again be done off the shelf. You just do a pip install, right? And using pre-built models for several libraries, you can get approximately most of the times these sentiments which is correctly classified as positive, negative, neutral, right? So we'll see, we'll try to see a small proof of concept how we can also build a aspect based sentiment analysis system, right? And here is where NLP will play a great role. Okay. Let's take these sentences, right, and do a thought experiment again, but this thought experiment will be aided by an NLP parse. So I'll show you an NLP parse, you tell me what is going on. You can go to this notebook called NLP_basic. So the NLP framework that I'll be using for the demo is based on a very popular library called Spacey. Could have shown you the same thing with something called NLTK as well, Cornell Parcel as well. But essentially, whatever NLP framework you use, it essentially does only those 4 or 5 tasks that I've shown you: named entity recognition, post tagging, figuring out what noun chunks are. So I'm using Spacey as off-the-shelf solution. So in order to identify which word is a noun, which word is a preposition, which bunch of words are noun phrases, Spacey already has some pre-trained machine learning models, right? So I'm using those pre-trained models on some sample sentences. So this is the first sentence. I love the camera in this mobile phone, but I hated the build quality. Let me parse it. So once you parse a sentence, you can do something like this. For each word, you can figure out what is its parts of speech tag. And this is coming from a pre-trained machine learning model, right? So for English, Spacey comes with some pre-trained machine learning models. If I were to do the same thing on some regional tribal language, I may have to train my models myself. For that, I'll first have to annotate the data, right? But for standard English, I get off-the-shelf solutions. Let me show this. Like this to you. So the problem statement that I have first is, I want to be able to pick up from a sentence or a bunch of sentences, what are the things that people are talking about. That's what I want to pick up. And I am postulating that a natural language processing parse will help me in doing that. That is what I'm saying, right? And here is an example of the parse, the same parse that I showed you in the for loop. This is a nice visualization of it. Look at this parse, right? If you have the cloud instance running, you can run that. You can run it there as well. And any observations? Any observations? This was a sentence. I loved the camera in this mobile phone, but I hated the build quality. What am I talking about in this sentence? Phone, yes, and what aspects of a phone? Camera and? Quality or build quality. Let's look at the parse. Camera is build quality is noun. Now this might be a coincidence. So let's run this over another sample and see if this is a coincidence. So what are we establishing? We are saying that the things that people talk about are usually nouns. This is what we are postulating, right? Okay. This is my second sentence. What is my second sentence? The beach has amazing views, food is great, drinks are even better, and locals are friendly. Let's parse it and display it. People have talked about what in this? Beach, food, drinks, locals. Let's see. Beach is a noun. Views is a noun. Food is a noun. Drinks is a noun. Locals is a noun. Right? So a very primitive way of figuring out what people are talking about in a corpus is to pass that corpus through any NLP system, figure out what is the POS tag of each word, figure out all the nouns, and if you do a frequency distribution of nouns, if you figure out top 5 nouns, that should potentially tell you what people are talking about, right? So the first thing in any aspect based sentiment analysis is generation of the aspect terms, right? And one way to generate aspect terms, especially when you don't know what the aspect terms should be, is to just do an NLP parse, label each word as noun, do a frequency distribution, count how many times a noun occurs. Most frequent nouns should be telling you what people are talking about. Any questions? Yes.
There was a sentence, I saw
Yeah. No, so you will have to. Okay. No. So most NLP systems will have a couple of ways to handle this, right? One is if the word was never in, when one is to always hard code each English word and just tell how it is used grammatically most of the times. Some libraries will do that. Some libraries will have pre-trained models, right? And some will have pre-trained models that may be able to generalize. For example, Spacey has a pre-trained model in this. Based on what is a word before and after, it may be able to correctly guess if Bahubali is a noun. But I cannot guarantee you that. If you want a guarantee for that, take an Indianized version of the corpus, retrain Spacey's models again. So Spacey, this library gives you the ability to modify existing models as well. So for example, if you want to make sure that some Indian words are recognized correctly as pause tags, you can manually annotate some of the Indianized corpus and update Spacey's models. That is how you will solve this problem. Let's run this and see what happens. Just repeat the sentence for me. Y2K, yes, we can run it. The Bahubali, what are we talking about? I saw Bahubali. It was great. Okay. I ate biryani and it was also great. Okay. I ate biryani and then like it. So it's triple quoted. Should be able to add a quote. So let me just write it like this. Let's parse it and let's see what happens. I'm not sure what will happen. Bahubali was identified as a pronoun. Proper noun. Yeah. It was and biryani. Proper noun. Right? So the NLP systems which are based on some pre-trained models should be able to guess. Should be able to do a reasonable guess. But you have to try this. And it's a very good point that you've brought out. What happens when you use those existing off-the-shelf libraries on a corpus which is slightly different, not Indianized? Let's uncapitalize it. And let's see what happens. Right? So this worked. Spacey should not say out of vocabulary, OOV. So anything that any parse that is based on ML should do something like this, should be able to guess. Yes. 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 I will not make that hard statement never. I will not do that. But most of the time, it should do a good job. Anything that is based on a pre-trained model should be able to, even if you're using a word which is out of vocabulary, the model had not seen it in the training, if the model is good, should be able to infer it correctly. And okay, let's do that. Let's just write Bahubali and see what happens. Oh, I need to parse it also. In a sense, it's correct. Yes. Let's experiment. I can't answer a priori. Let's experiment. So give me a sentence which is grammatically messed up. Something like a Twitter speak. Let's collaborate. What should I write?
Bah.
Super. Let's do it this way. Bahubali super. Biryani. Not super. Let's see what happens. This is more like it. Let's see what happens. I need to parse. Adjective. So it's not based on a preset rules. Every time it passes through a model and then guesses what the pause tag should be, right? So now we know where this will not work, right? So grammar, it most of this is species models are trained on corpus, standard English corpus. Grammar is grammatical rules are respected, right? And if we see something like a food review, I won't say that these kind of reviews will not exist in the corpus. They should be rare. They would be rare. Usually if you go to Zomato, people usually write long reviews, pour their heart out in chaste grammatical terms, right? So again, it depends, but this NLP framework is based on an ML model. We are using a pre-trained one. Okay, so what have we concluded? We've concluded that if you want to figure out what people are talking about and people somehow respect the rules of grammar, not every time but broadly, then the nouns are the ones you should be looking at, because nouns are conveying you what people are talking about. This is a conclusion we've gotten. With some caveats, of course. You have a question? I mean, any form of noun. Yeah, any form of noun. Yeah. Yeah. So usually what I'll do is, I will first convert the text into lowercase and then do the parse. That is under my control. So proper noun situation may not occur. If even if it occurs, I can still, that's my code. It's an if-else statement, I can change it. Right? All right. So here we are. Look at the nouns for a corpus where grammatical rules are somewhat respected, and if you look at the top nouns, you should be able to get what people are talking about. Fine. What next? Let's look at a small piece of code. So some time ago, Amazon was doing this. Around 3-4 months ago, Amazon was doing this in the comment section. Now in the comment, just before the start of the comment section, you will see more than two words these days. You will see good wireless. So it's probably changed something. But if we had to replicate what Amazon was doing 2-3 months ago, then all we need to do is pass the comments through an NLP framework and figure out the top 5 lines, right? And we should be able to get something like this. If my internet works, I think we can visit Amazon. Let's choose any product, Oppo. So you can see that screenshot was from Amazon 4 months ago, right? So now I think what Amazon is doing is it is trying to parse, instead of just nouns, it is trying to parse noun phrases, bunch of words that act as nouns, right? So that also can be done using SPACY, right? I can also extract noun phrases. So for example, right, I can extract chunks, noun chunks, also using SPACY, bunch of words that act as phrases, and then look at its frequency count. Probably this is what Amazon is doing now, right? Probably this is what it is doing, but 3-4 months ago I think it was just extracting top nouns, right? So if we had to do something that Amazon was doing 3-4 months ago, I can just write a simple function. I can manually create a list of words that I want to ignore in the NLP parse, define a function that is extracting nouns, then do a frequency count. So let's run this and see if we can. So here are a couple of reviews that I copied from Amazon. Let's just run. So it has picked up phone, price, phones, percentage, screen. It is just one comment. If I had a lot of comments, I think I should have been able to figure out some aspects. It's just a one comment, one long comment that I pasted here. You can experiment with other comments, see if this approach works, right? Okay. Yeah.
So for these noun phrases, does it pick up something which is related to both the nouns, or how does it kind of work? I'll give you the example that this would have come would be very, very handy.
Okay.
We were doing the sentiment analysis for automobile.
Hmm.
And it appeared that a lot of automobile features were dual, so disc brake, steering wheel.
Hmm. Okay.
And we have a do hand crafted. And there was no other way, but we just kind of list. Okay. Though we didn't have to do it, but we had to write it because all those words we could pull from the automobile side. But both the words were kind of noun. Does this help in those kind of scenarios?
So one approach would be to extract noun phrases, figure out how long they are in terms of word. Do they contain two words? If they contain two words, just do a frequency count on that token. That could have been one approach. Another approach that could have worked, again it boils down to creating some handcrafted rules. This is a better example. So actually, so another thing that you can do is, you can look at, so this is an NLP parse. Think of this as head and think of this as its child, right? So you can figure out for each noun what are the childs and do a frequency count on them. That's another approach you could have probably tried. I'm not sure if it would have worked, but that you could have tried. Right, and you can put another filter, and that's where NLP becomes a convoluted list of if-else statements. Another thing that you could have done is, from this parse tree, you could have figured out the adjective preceding or succeeding the noun, and done a frequency count.
So there was a noun phrase, and what other phrase did you mention?
This only gives you noun chunks, so I can. Let's look at, this is my parse. Let's look at what are the methods supported in it. Print out the dir of parse. these are the methods supported on it. As far as chunks are concerned, what do I see here? Noun chunks, anything else I see? No. Noun chunks. So this API restricted to noun chunks. Take a look at Stanford. There's a Stanford parser as well. It's a Java library, but it'll have a Python API as well. Check that. What does it give you? Or else, parse it. Figure out the noun. Figure out the adjective preceding or succeeding. Both are nouns. Steering wheel. Okay, everything is a noun. It picked up as. So one is pick up, one is just do a parse of the tree. The other is do a frequency distribution on noun chunks extracted, restrict them to two words and see what happens. Right? Okay. Okay. So sometimes we may not know what the aspects are, and when we don't know what the aspects are, you do the NLP parse, figure out top nouns, and you should know what people are talking about. Sometimes you do know what the aspects are. For example, if I'm doing a restaurant review, what should I be worried about? Food, ambience, service, right? So now the problem is still the extraction of aspects, but it's more in terms of aspect synonyms. I want to know what are the occurrence of all the food related items, what are the occurrences of all the service related items, what are the occurrences of all the ambience related items. So now the problem is slightly different. The Zomato's problem is slightly different, right? Amazon's problem is slightly different. Amazon just wants to inform you what the comments talk about. Zomato wants to tell you in this restaurant food is good, ambience is good, or something else is good. So here we already know what aspects we want to extract, right? So what can we do? We need a way to help us in telling, given a word, what are the synonyms or words which occur in similar context of that word. So for example, if I say extract all the mentions of food, burger, pizza, chicken, everything should be extracted. Now this is a problem, right? So a very rudimentary way of solving this problem was a couple of years ago using something called a WordNet, right? So what is WordNet? WordNet is a hierarchy of words that are interrelated. So for example, if I say mammal, it will have a cat, it will have a dog, it will have a human. So it's a tree with related concepts. So one way to solve this problem is to use WordNet, but this is MLDL conference, and if I don't talk about deep learning, you will say kuch nahi kiya. So let's talk about deep learning. So another way to solve this problem is use something called word vectors, right? Word vectors, right? So let's talk a little bit about, let's see what word vectors do, and then I'll talk about how they are created, and then I'll talk about how you can use them, right? So let's first see what word vectors do. So if I head out to, let me close this notebook called word vectors. So I'll explain what they are. Let's first see what they can do for us. Let's just get some visual feel. Then we'll see how they are created and how we can consume them as a user. There are off-the-shelf word vectors available. This will take some time. So essentially, as far as consumption of word vectors is concerned, word vectors are nothing. They are just text files with words and their numeric representation. And the numeric representation is created in such a way that words which occur in a similar context, they have similar distance. They are not very far apart. Right? So that's a general idea. It's just a text file which I have just read in. And I can do something like this. I can figure out what are the synonyms for a word called food. This is what I get. I can figure out what is the similarity between one term and the other. This is what I get. And this is exactly what your WordNet also tries to do. It tries to tell you which words are similar. So before there were word vectors, there was WordNet. So people used to use WordNet a lot. Any questions? WordNet is actually a hand created graph that people have built over the years. So it's hand curated. You start with one concept and then you figure out what are the other concepts of it. You start with mammal and list out all the mammals. I'll talk about that. First, I wanted to show what it does. So that the task we are at, that is at hand, what is the task at hand? Once I know what aspects I want to fetch, how do I fetch them? So both NLP and word vectors can come in handy, right? So this is what they do. Now let's try and figure out how word vectors how word vectors are obtained, right? So what you usually do is you start with a very big corpus of text, something like a Wikipedia corpus, 10 gigs of data, 14 gigs of data. That is your training data. And what do you do? Before we come to that, let's, you've talked about this, okay. So we start with a very big corpus of data, very, very big corpus, standard English or colloquial English, right? Then what we do is we map each word in the corpus to any integer, this choice is arbitrary. So the intention here is to treat each sentence or each sequence of words as a sequence of numbers, right? So we convert words into numbers. This choice is arbitrary. You can write your own mapper to do this, right? This choice is arbitrary. Then because in my corpus, some sentences can be really long, some sentences can be really short, some fragments can be really long, really short. So I figure out a way to somehow standardize. And the way you standardize is you pad your sequences, meaning if some sequences are long, you chop them off. If some sequences are short, you add some zeros to them. And you decide what is the length of the ideal sequence that you want to consider. Then what you do is you pass these sequence of numbers through a neural network architecture, and this architecture will have three components, right? One component will be what we call as embedding layer. Then I'll have some intermediate layers, and at last I'll do a classification task, so I'll have a softmax layer. Okay, let's talk about the embedding layer, because this is the layer that helps me in figuring out the word vectors, right? So for each word, let's assume in my corpus I have 10,000 unique words. Then this embedding layer will have 10,000 rows, right? And for each row, meaning for each word, I will first assign any random sequence of numbers, right? Usually these numbers are either 8 long, 64 long, 128 long, 300 long. So each word is represented by either a sequence of numbers which runs into 300, 124, 64. That again is a choice that I make, right? Or Google makes, right? So this is the embedding layer, right? Initially these numbers for each word are randomly assigned. Then I do training on my data. What I do is I pass the sequence, each sequence through this network, And schematically, this looks something like this. I pass this word, then this word, then this word, then this word, do a forward pass, backward pass, train my model. But what is the training task that I am doing? I can do two kinds of training tasks. One is for each word, I can try to predict what are its neighbors. The other is for each neighbor, I can try to predict what is the context word, right? And based on that, you can have two kinds of model. One is called skipgram model, one is called continuous bag of words model. So within the neural network, you are passing each sequence of sentence as a sequence of integers. For each integer, you have a vector representation. And what are you doing? You are trying to predict either from this word, the center word, or from the center word, the neighbors. You can do two different tasks. You can do either, the results are kind of similar. But what are you learning in this? You are learning to predict, if these are the two words, what will be this word? If I say this a little more concretely, what are you learning? You are learning which words occur together. You are trying to predict, if this is the word here, what is the word here? This is the learning task you are doing, right? So when you do this learning task, you end up learning some weights over here. What were these weights? These were representation of each of the words, right? So this is how word vectors are created. This task requires some specialized hardware and a lot of data. So usually I will not create word vectors. I will use word vectors that have already been created. For example, I can use word vectors that Facebook has created, they are called fast text. I can create word vectors that Google has created, they are called word2vec. So I use just pre-trained word vectors. If you just Google on word vectors, you will get links to GitHub repositories or Google Drives where you already have the text files. Now if you think about it, how can this embedding layer be saved on your computer? I have a word, colon, a series of numbers. It's a text file, right? This is what word vectors are. And I'm using a very small pre-trained word vector corpus, which is around 800 MB. So if you use Facebook's word vectors, they can run around 10 gigs uncompressed. So you'll need some specialized hardware to make it work. I personally don't know if there is a way to compress them even further, because there can be production issues, right? So these are word vectors, right? Essentially what this neural network architecture is learning, it is learning to predict which words occur together. When it learns to predict that, it also learns to form a numeric representation of words. And that numeric representation of words is learnt in a manner, if you find the cosine distance of similar words, their cosine distance will be small after the training is done, right? This is what I showed you. So when I do this, right, I am essentially finding out the cosine distance between the word vector representing food and the word vector representing pizza. This is what I get. Okay. Let's go back to our original problem. What was the original problem? Anyone? What were we trying to solve for? So we said there can be scenarios like Zomato, where I may know what are the things important to me, occurrences of food, ambience, service, and I may want to extract the words corresponding to them, right? So this was the original problem. So how will I solve for it? Two steps. First, I will do my regular noun phrase parse, figure out all the nouns, then within those nouns figure out the mentions of food or service or whatever I want to find out. This is what I will do, right? So let's work with this small model. This is the smallest model I could find, and see how well it performs. Let's go to restaurant reviews. If you run this on cloud, this will be slow, right? The machine there is very small. So I have taken some restaurant reviews. The first thing I'll do is, from each review, I'll append a new column to this data set, put all the nouns. Then I will do a pass over the nouns, figure out which words are similar to, let's say, food or service or something like that. Let's see if we are able to do anything useful. So I'll need spacey. Why? Because I need to do a noun parse, POS parse. So let's parse and let's look at. So we are very close to, I'm very close to showing you how a aspect-based sentiment system will work. So far I've been able to tell you how to extract sentiments. Now I'm telling you, if you know sentiment, if you know aspect categories, how do you figure out the mentions? So I'm first doing a noun parse. Extracted all the nouns from each review. This is what I've done. Then I'll read my word vectors. And this is the piece of code that, if we remember this, right? This is the piece of code that goes through each word in the noun phrase, figures out if it is similar to food or not. I put a threshold here. I can change the threshold. This is something which I'll do hit and trial every time. And then we'll extract the mentions of food. Let it load. Okay, so let's create this function. Let's run this. Let's see. What have we extracted? What happened? So here I extracted the occurrences where I had extracted nouns. I figured out which nouns are occur in the context of the word food. Let's see if we've picked up anything useful. Wine we were able to pick up, right? And most of the times we are just able to do an exact match, food, food, food. The reason this is not working very well, I'm using a very small word vector file, right? If you use something like fast text, you should see it picking up, for example, cake, dessert, something like that. Here I built a function which extracts all the words that occur in the context of service. Time, stop, service, experience, quality. So directionally, we were able to extract some things over here, right? What's the next task? Right? So this is what we've schematically done. Yes. Not individual. First I, so all of this is computationally very expensive. Even the pause tagging is very expensive, right? And the cosine matching is also expensive. So the first thing I do is, the very first thing that I've done is, I've extracted from each review, what are the nouns? In each review, what are the nouns? This is what I've extracted. Then I am looping over these nouns. Then I'm looping over these nouns and figuring out if this word occurs in the context of word food. Holiday, does it occur in the context of food? If it does, then I append it. If it doesn't, then I leave it. So on and so forth. So I'm just doing this matching over the nouns that I've extracted. That is what I'm doing. Yes. Sorry? this one, let me see if I can figure out programmatically for you. I don't remember. Let me see. It's word to vec. Let's see if there is a method too. Or what I can do is I can go to the text file and figure out how many lines that the text file has. Those would be the number of words. So let me try and do that. Someone will have to help me with the bash commands. How do you count the number of lines in a text file? Word count slash l. That's what we do. So let's see. Go to data. Doesn't go inside it. Okay. So I will do this. This is the word vector file. Glove dot 6b dot 100 d dot txt. So this is how I'll do it. WC minus L, then file name. This is how it works. Dot txt. So these many, how many? 4 lakh. So 4 lakh words in this corpus. Yes. So again we can add one layer in the pre-processing where I go over all the words and correct the spellings. Run the spell checker, correct the spellings, then do the noun parsing, then do this. So can be multiple layers, but I am just trying to explain broadly how this can be accomplished. Right? Broadly this is how it can be accomplished. I am working with a file, with a word vector file which is relatively not that big. You have bigger word vectors. So if you go to, yeah, here, I think you'll have word vectors for some other languages as well. And if you look at the files are available both in text and binary format. Binary formats helps in reading files faster. And they are English corpus is around 10 gigs, right? So it'll have a lot more words. No, you don't. But again, the problem is you'll have to train the word vectors yourself. So GenSim can help you train the word vectors. You'll have to make sure that you have requisite hardware resources. Although even on a laptop, it may take a day to run, but it will run. Right? It's not as quick as just doing an API call, but you can. So if you have your corpus, you can probably just train word vectors. GenSim gives you an API to train them in word to vec format. Using this, NLP comes with, so if I do an NLP parse, let me show you. Where is, this is the one. So, any NLP library will have the ability to do named entity recognition itself, and most have the ability to ID the words and say this is the name of an organization. So you just need to do an NLP parse then, but this can also be, I think, done. Maybe if we say Reliance, all the words that occur in the context of Reliance will also show up, right? All the good and bad words, doesn't mean only the competitors. So the idea is to learn words that co-occur, learn their numeric representation that co-occur. K can be a hack, what you are suggesting, but a cleaner way would be to just use the NLP parse itself and figure out the named entity named entity. That is there. Here was a question. Yeah. So you can see this is 4 lakh and it's not doing a very good job. In say food and in say pizza, it says it, the cosine distance is 0.449. If you can collect that kind of corpus, then yes. If you can collect those many words, if you can collect a corpus, sufficiently large number of words that occur together, then it is a good solution. If you can't, then it's not. Then the only thing that you can do is, that people still use, is called WordNet. So you can probably just do WordNet. WordNet is faster, but again it'll also have similar kind of problems with it, because WordNet is handcrafted. Someone is actually sitting there, a group of people are actually sitting there and saying, this class, these are the words, this is how they are related. It's a handcrafted graph, right?
For text classification, would you use a PF IDF matrix or a word vector?
You can use word vectors, but then you may have to forego the use of classical classifiers. For example, for a logistic regression, the only way for me to use a word vector representation is to sum or to take the average of all the in a sentence. That may be destroying the meaning, I don't know, you have to. Or if you want to use word vectors, then use a neural network framework, use an RNN, use an LSTM. So in an RNN LSTM, I can put in a custom, I can load my own word vectors. So then I'm not training for the embedding layer, I'm only training the other layers, the RNN, the LSTM, and any layer that precedes or succeeds it. Yes. Fast text is one. Fast text is one. Glove vectors are another. Word2Vec is a Google implementation.
Elmo is also there. Elmo. It's trained on bidirectional
LSTM. So many. Fast text, glove, word2vec, Elmo. So that is what we can do. So the general idea would be this. And I can't vouch for if Zomato exactly does this or something else, but this is what I think that they are doing, right? So you have a review, you have food and service mentions, you figure out food and service mentions by first doing some text processing, noun parsing, parse the nouns through word vectors, figure out the words that occur in the context of these concepts. Now once you have those words, what I'll do is I'll, one naive thing I can do with the sentiment analysis, you have a question? One thing that I can do, I think you had a question. I'll come to that in a minute. Yeah. So now all the thing I'll have to do is, I know where this aspect occurs. I can go back to that sentence and figure out the mood of that sentence. That's a very naive thing to do, right? Another thing that I can do is, I can go back to that sentence and figure out what is the adjective precedes or succeeds this particular aspect words. For example, using word2vec, I figured out that pizza is an instance of food and I was interested in food. I'll go back to my corpus, figure out where pizza occurs, and then using the NLP parse, figure out what, if there is an adjective preceding or succeeding it. If the adjective comes from a list of positive words, then people are talking good about pizza. If it comes from a list of negative words, people are talking bad about the pizza. But here you'll have to handcraft some NLP parse and NLP rules. That's one way to do it. Another is a naive implementation. You go back to the sentence where this aspect term occurs, figure out the sentiment of the whole sentence itself. That's easier to code. So that is what I've done. So let's go to sentiment analysis. So again, most of the times, sentiment analyzers are available off the shelf. It's a pip install. Although, if you're working if you're working for a language in a particular domain, you may want to train your own, right? But if all you're doing is a small MVP, then this approach is good enough. I won't say this is a long-term approach that you should use, but this is a good enough. We'll get you started, right? So we have sentiment analyzers available off the shelf. What they do is, for each word, for each sentence, they look out. They have a pre-built list of positive, negative words. Some are even more sophisticated. They first do an NLP parse, figure out what the adjectives are, and they have a pre-built list of adjectives which are positive and negative. They just do a simple count. If the number of positive words are more than number of negative words, then the sentiment of the sentence is positive, right? So I'll just use a off-the-shelf implementation. There's something called TextBlob. So I'll take the file where I had done this parse, right? So what I'll do is I will see where the food occurs in the review, the sentence where it occurs, and then I'll figure out if that sentence has a positive or a negative sentiment. How do I do that? I'll show you. Let's say I say I love this place. Right, so this should give me a number ranging from -1 to +1. 0 is neutral, anything that is negative is a negative sentiment, anything that is positive is a positive sentiment. So, and this relies on a pre-built list of adjectives. So this is first doing an NLP parse of the sentence, figuring out what the adjectives are, matching those adjectives with a pre-built list of adjectives which are positive and negative, and figuring out the polarity. Okay. I do not. Let's see what happens. Still says the same, right? So this is because it's built on a list. It's a lexical sentiment. It uses lexicons. It's not using any sort of intelligence in terms of a pre-built model. Okay. So let's. So this is a function that looks at the aspect term that I extracted, goes back to the sentence, figures out the polarity of the sentence, and then I am figuring out the mean sentiment of the review itself. So this will take some time to run, but this was a very basic approach to aspect-based sentiment analysis. Till the time it runs, so whatever I've talked so far is something which is unsupervised, which is mostly exploratory. I have not built any machine learning model. I've just used off-the-shelf equipment available to me and done an MVP. If, in my opinion, if you want to do something on a long-term basis, you should use an ML approach, wherein you will tag each of the review and figure out what are the aspect terms, what are the sentiment terms, and use either POS tags or some other text representation as an input to build an ML model. That will be a long-term solution. But as you can see, doing this is very labor-intensive, right? This will take a very, very long time to annotate the data in this manner if you have to come up with a custom ML solution. You'll actually have to literally tag each sentence and then model for it. But that should be a long-term solution. Whatever I've talked about with some tweaks can be executed as an MVP at least, as a prototype at least, right? Yeah, there are tools available for tagging this. There are tools. There are many GitHub repos where people have built Django-like UIs, built on Django. There's a UI, you put the file, you highlight something, and then you annotate it, then you highlight something and annotate it. It creates a tree-like representation in JSON or XML for you. There are tools available to annotate this kind of data in this manner, but even if the tool is available, it still is going to take some time. Right?
So labeling was like we have to put it in a JSON or like can we put it in XML or something? If you are putting this,
it's a matter of your workflow, whatever suits you. Yeah, that's a question of what your workflow looks like, which formats you prefer. Usually, since you're building a tree like this, your input is a tree, your labels probably are also tree. So JSON XML is a good way to store it. Then you can parse it whatever way you want to parse it. Right? So let's see if it ran. It did. So this is the average sentiment for all the aspects that were identified using the Vertuvec. Right? This is what we get. Since nothing was extracted here, so you're getting a 0 over here by default. Right? So you can tweak these if else rules yourself, but that should, but that is an attempt to explain how this can be accomplished. So there are three major parts. One is the ability to do an NLP parse. The other is the ability to extract noun phrases. The third is the ability to extract the synonyms. You can extract synonyms in any which way. I've shown you how to extract them using word vectors, right? So this is where I stop. I would have liked to spend more time, but this setup is something where I cannot ask you to run code and I can enforce that you bring your laptops and run codes. So the 3 hours that were talked about in the agenda included hands-on by you as well, but I can still take Q&A. We'll be open to questions, please let me know. I'll come. Yes, it's a dual core machine. GPU will be required if you want to train it. If you just want to run it, just make sure that you have more cores in the machine. Make sure that your code is parallelizable. You can run on a given code, you can parallelize it. So make sure that all the cores are utilized. Then you don't need a really big machine. There's a question. Yes, they're available. This is the GitHub repo. Okay. This is the GitHub repo. All the codes are here. Right. And all the slides are here. I will let the lab run for a couple of days. Then I'll shut it down. Any other questions? Yeah. If you have the budget and the time, then label your data in train models.
No, I'm just trying to understand, is it the deep learning methods that people are using to do something else? What is state of the art today?
the people that I know, some of them are still using synsets, WordNet and all. Word2Vec is something that I included because I could talk about Word2Vec and I could show you that it can do something useful. But traditionally, word vectors are used in a supervised framework where you use an LSTM RNN, and the embedding layer is your Word2Vec. That is pre-trained. You are not learning it yourself. It reduces the training time. That is where it is most commonly used. This was a hack that I showed you using Word2Vec. You had a question? Yeah.
Those kind of things. So, how can we get a lead, make a lead, that is identify the entity, company name?
Yeah. So, you have a named entity recognizer pre-built in most NLP frameworks. You can try that. For most companies, it will just label it as an organization, and you can filter out.
But that means most of the companies, like Apple, Google, those companies will have it also. Then most of the Indian companies, Indian or some.
Another thing you can do is Spacy gives you the ability to bootstrap, meaning you can modify the existing models, meaning you can bring in a little bit more labeled data. For example, all the you make a list of all the instances of Indian company names that some NLP framework, for example Spacy, was not able to recognize. You label them as company names and then you modify the existing model that is built into it. It should be able to then recognize. You bootstrap, right? Yeah, there is an API available to use Spacy and modify the existing models as well. That you can do. Okay. Whatever you've done is what probably most people will do, and what I would also do. Not that I know of. Can this be translated into a problem which is supervised? Can you label the data? Then that's another approach. See if word vectors are able to find out what occurs in the context of Java, what occurs in the context of Oracle, what occurs in the context of C#. See if it is able to. There is Wikipedia dump. Let me go to. So if you go over here, fast text, it tells you which corpuses it was trained on. And you can take that reference and figure out if those corpuses are available in open source and do your own experiments. For example, these standard word vectors are trained on something called Wikinews dump. And I think Wikinews dump is available for open source use. So there are dumps available. Now these are pre-trained vectors. These are embeddings. Yeah, so this should give you this should tell you which corpuses were used, right? And then we can, you know, figure out if those corpuses are available for open source use. For example, Wikipedia dump is available for open source use. You can use different corpus. You just have to train for yourself. Yeah, no problem. You just have to train those vectors again on your corpus. Not necessarily. For example, if you just visit the website of GenSim, the creator of GenSim, while explaining Word2Vec training, tells you that he trained on, I think, Google dump or Wikipedia dump using a MacBook machine and it took around 16 hours. So it's not a that big a deal. If you have cloud available, you can just run the job, go to sleep, wake up the morning. These are the corpuses that are available. You can, this is your baseline. If this works, then why to go through the pain of training yourself? If it doesn't work, then you experiment.